Okay, thank you, Maarten. First of all, I'll do this in English because, like you'll see, is that much of my presentation is actually in English words, and that would be sort of awkward to do it and in Nederlands en dan al die Engelse woorden tussendoor. Niemand wil dat. Nog even uitleggen waarom Nirvana, in tegenstelling tot veel mensen denken, Amazon is geen bedrijf uit Silicon Valley. We komen uit Seattle, de hoofdstad van grunge. En zonder meer Nirvana is onze staple, of course, als het gaat om grunge muziek. Ik ga vandaag praten over drie dingen. And so let's switch to English. That is hard, actually. So there's three things that I want to talk to you about. First of all, I've been asked to talk a bit about what are the principles behind the Amazon business? What are the kind of things that drives all this innovation, all this continuous innovation that is happening at Amazon? In the second part, I'll try to talk a bit about some of the new programs that we've put in place that many people often ask us about, whether it's talking about Prime or the Dash button and things like that. And then thirdly, I'll talk about, go a bit more technical, hopefully that it doesn't scare people, and talk about sort of the cloud business that Amazon is in, together with all the analytics that many retailers are doing on our platform. And of course, Amazon itself as well. So, that's me. That's Amsterdam in the background, by the way. I'm from this town, really proud to be back here. If you want to complain about any of this presentation on Twitter, I'm Werner. I want to take you back to 1997, when Jeff Bezos, who's the founder of Amazon, wrote his first letter to shareholders when the company went public. So Amazon was founded in 1995. And in it, he really lays out the principles of Amazon. And the first one is actually one that's really well known by now. We're a company that's in this for the long term. If you are a short-term investor, probably Amazon is not the best stock to invest in. Yeah, and if you know, over the years, we've been really at odds often with sort of the short-term markets. Yeah, we continue to invest. You know, free cash flow last year was $2 billion. But in the end, I think we didn't really make that much of a profit there because we invest most of the things that we do back into the company. I think retail, and especially online retail, is an area that is still booming. And we still need to invest to actually mature this market much further than where it is now. Yeah, if you look at Amazon's revenue last year, was around $100 billion. In retail in the US, sort of $6 trillion is being spent. There's a lot more for us to do there. There's a lot more hearts to win to bring them online and to bring shopping online. That's the second thing. And the second line in that letter to shareholder is really important. And it drives a lot of the processes that we have at Amazon. Yeah? We continue to measure our programs and learn from them. Yeah? So for us, it is we are in this mode and continue to be in this mode to experiment continuously, yeah? To then measure relentlessly and learn from it. And the last part is really important. You have to pull the plug on things that don't work. And the cheaper you make it to actually do these experiments, the easier you make it to do these experiments, the faster you also pull the plug on things that actually don't work. Now, if you just had to spend $100,000 in hardware to actually get this program off the ground, before you pull the plug on it, you'll think twice. Probably also because internally your personal, let's say, standing in the company is associated with that particular project. Yeah? And so if you're able to pull the plug quickly, you can actually go into many different alleys. So we are we're well known for actually having this as our core motto in the company, to be the Earth's most customer-centric company. Yeah, and this is not a marketing trick. This is really that drives everything. We believe that if you build a company in the long term, purely focused on customer success, not on shareholder success, but on customer success, you will win the trust of your customers. And also by actually helping them make decisions that might even be negatively impacting yourself. For example, you might help them make a decision not to buy that book. Yeah, or you might actually help them to make a decision to go to a different website and buy the products there, because that's the right thing to do. Customers will trust you because of that. And so what is sort of core to this customer centricity is, of course, you have to listen to your customers. You have to put all sorts of mechanisms and tools in place so that you can actually listen to them. We use our Amazon inventive powers to then build unique programs around it. And then you have to personalize. Personalization is extremely important. We have, let's say, if we have 300 million customers, we want to have 300 million websites. Yeah? In real time, you need to build a completely personalized environment for your customers. And you know, if you think about invention, and I think invention is sort of the principle, and innovation is sort of the process around it. If you think about innovation, we often think about totally new things, radically new processes, things that we've never done before, yeah, and all of these things. But sometimes, I think especially in retail, it is very important to think about the things that will never change for your customers. Because if there are things that will forever be important for your customers, any ounce of energy that you put into innovating over those dimensions will benefit your customers forever. Yeah, and so these are sort of the three staples, I think, in any kind of retail. Yeah, selection, that is the size of your catalog, the number of products that you have available. Yeah, low pricing. Nobody's going to say 10 years from now, I love Amazon, I wish they were more expensive. It's not going to happen. Yeah, and as such, the further you can drive any cost efficiency that you can achieve, so that you can drive your pricing lower, will benefit your customers forever. And convenience as well. The way that you buy things, the way that you can buy things, but also the guarantees that you can give on hardcore shipping deliveries, for example. So anything you do there will benefit your business and the customer forever. And we do that by what we call building flywheels. I don't know if any of you are engineers, but flywheels are these magical kind of devices. I mean, you used to have them in trams in the back. Yeah, there used to be a big wheel that if the tram would actually slow down, the energy of the tram would go into this flywheel. This wheel would start turning and would actually hold all the energy. And then when the tram would go again, the energy would be taken out of that flywheel and make the tram go again. It's a magical device. It's actually still used quite often today in actually storing, for example, wind and sun energy that you get from your roof. And if you don't have enough accus, you can actually still use this flywheel to store it as physical energy or physical motion. So let's look at some of these flywheels, of these two flywheels that we talked about earlier. So growth is something that every company is definitely interested in. Yeah? For us, selection, so the size of the catalog, the likelihood that your customers can find what they're looking for in your catalog is extremely important. I remember recently one of the top guys at Google making the statement publicly that they thought that Amazon these days was the default search engine for product search. And why is that? Because the selection, the catalog is so huge that the likelihood that you will find the product that you're looking for at Amazon is very high. It also means that often for a significant portion of our traffic, it's pure research traffic. Yeah, customers that come to our site to actually look at products, to read the reviews, and things like that. So selection is important. Selection drives the customer experience. And low pricing, to be honest, you know, as much as people say that they're not really interested in low pricing, or they seem to be doing a bit like, about it, everybody loves low pricing. Yeah? So those two drive customer experience, they drive traffic to your site. If you have traffic on your site, you get more people to sell on your site. Remember, we also have this third-party business. Yeah, so you bring more sellers to the site, which means it brings more selection to your site. At this moment, you really have this first flywheel, because this thing will keep itself going. Yeah, so you get this flywheel going, wrong button, there, that will continue to grow, because larger selection means more customers to the site, more traffic, more sellers, brings more selection. Now, if you do that right, then you get economies of scale out of that one, and you get a lower cost structure, which you then either can pocket, if that's what you want to, or you can use that to actually drive your pricing down again. So now you have a second flywheel there as well. So these two things will continue to amplify each other forever. So any innovation we do in this area, in these two flywheels, will only accelerate those two flywheels. It will benefit customers forever. So sometimes you have to innovate in these areas because they are the most beneficial to your customers. If you are a company that's all looking at the long term, you have to be willing to cannibalize your existing business at times. I remember when, Amazon at one moment for a long time, 3-4 years, was actually the only seller on this platform. Yeah, so we would buy the goods, we would sell them, we would be the seller on record for everything. But we saw that if our goal was to achieve the world's largest catalog, we realized that we could not do that by ourselves. Yeah, because we're just not growing fast enough to fill the catalog up with all the goods in the world. So inviting third parties, other sellers on our platform, to sell on our platform, seemed like a good idea to achieve that goal. But that's a long-term goal. Short-term, all our own buyers were going crazy. Like, do I now have to compete on my own platform with others that actually may even have lower pricing than that we have? And the answer is yes, because that's the best thing to do for our customers. Yeah, in the long term, they get a large catalog, and actually, if they get better service or better pricing from third parties, then that's also better for your customers. And so we allowed third parties to join us on the platform, and now 43% of the orders in Q4 last year came from third parties. That turns out to be a really good business to be in. And helping these small businesses to get in front of 300 million customers, yeah, even if no matter how small they are. And most of these sellers consider this sort of relationship with Amazon to be very beneficial. And it's a win-win for everyone. It's a win for customers. It is a win for sellers. It's a win for Amazon. Yeah, these are not zero-sum games. Another thing that we did in the sort of cannibalization sphere, these days, all of these things that Amazon did early on, everybody else does as well. Yeah, we pioneered these things. Now everybody's taking these things over as well. And it's fine. But you do have to, it is a signal of that if we don't continue to innovate as Amazon, everybody else will catch up. And actually, I'm not that worried about catch up. I think I'm much more worried about that if we wait long enough, there will be another business arising on the internet that will be way more compelling and way more interesting than Amazon is. I just don't know what it is. We just hope that we're getting there first before somebody else does. But it's pretty normal for a business to be disintermediated over time. I mean, it's a normal cycle of business. I mean, how many businesses do you know that are more than 100 years old? There aren't that many. Yeah, and so for us, we know that if we don't continue to invest in innovation, in building new products as well, that eventually we will be disintermediated by someone, we just don't know who. And I would like to prefer to delay this until I'm dead. So self-service is one of those things that were considered in the early days to be cannibalization as well. People say, then they're going to cancel their orders. Well, maybe they should. If they want to cancel the orders, maybe you should allow them to do that. Yeah, instead of creating these barriers for your customers, you should actually try to really help them make those decisions. If they want to cancel things, fine. You know, make it as easy as possible for them. In all of this, and I talked earlier already about the research side of Amazon around products, a very, very important part of all of that research is reading reviews. Yeah, and so you would not believe how much effort our customers put into writing reviews. Yeah, and many of these reviews are extremely high quality. And as such, it's not just giving them 3 stars and a one-liner like, yeah, these shoes fit well. Yeah, but it is really, they really go into depth. And for fun, you should actually visit some of the more esoteric pages on Amazon. Go look, we sell milk. Go look for milk. See what opinions people have about this particular bottle of 2% milk. Yeah? You won't believe how passionate people are about milk. Or in this case, about toilet paper. Yeah? This actually is recycled toilet paper. It doesn't mean it was toilet paper before, but it meant it was paper and then turned it into toilet paper. And apparently, one side of this is really soft and the other side is a bit more rough. read the reviews. People are so into toilet paper. You wouldn't believe. But it's extremely important. It is extremely important. If reviews are offline for whatever technical reason or whatever, sales plummet. Really. Because people really trust each other, trust the opinion of each other. This is one of the staples of Amazon's existence. Yeah, and if you look at this is all about mobile. I'm not really sure whether I say. So mobile is actually playing a very important role in all of this. Yeah, and we often see where people are with the Amazon mobile app, what they're doing at that moment, and quite often they are standing in a particular store somewhere. Yeah, they may be standing in Best Buy, they may be standing in Nordstrom or whatever, wanting to buy a product and go onto Amazon to actually read the reviews. Yeah, and so this number is a hardcore number from. From last holiday season, 60% of the orders placed on Amazon came from a mobile device. Yeah? And the closer you got to December 25, the higher that number became. Yeah? There's a lot of guilt buying at the last moment, standing somewhere, going like, oh shit, I didn't get that. Yeah? And still ordered on Amazon and still got it delivered the next day, of course. Yeah, this is important to it. If I often people ask me, so what would you do if you could build Amazon again? Mobile first is a big term, but I would definitely look at what is the very different behavior of shoppers these days from what it was, let's say, when we built Amazon first, when all the shopping basically was either from a laptop or from a desktop computer. Yeah, the times when order times have changed dramatically as well. For example, the high peak of shoe ordering used to be lunchtime. That was in general when people were sitting behind their computer at work, and probably eating their lunch, just shopping shoes. Yeah, that's no longer the case. Yeah, it is. There's a lot of, let's say, laying on the couch with your tablet and just doing shopping. This is a very important thing to realize. Customers have perfect information. That means that there's no way to trick customers with one sale. They will know that you've tricked them. First of all, from our perspective, there is no gain in actually tricking customers. Yeah, the second-hand car salesman, the sort of prototypical second-hand car salesman that just was only interested in selling this car to you and he didn't really care whether he would come back. For us, this business is all about repeat customers, in all of bringing your customers back. And so you know that customers, then you know that if they paid more for this product than they could buy from a third party, they know this. You can't trick them. And if they wouldn't know it immediately, they'll definitely know it 2 days later or 2 weeks later. And your trust will erode. And trust is the absolute currency that you have. Yeah, this is famous saying that it takes a long time to gain trust. It takes seconds to lose it. And so that means that you have to be continuously on your toes to make your customers feel that you are worth their trust. So there's another side to all of this. One of the things that is really hard for many of our customers is choice. I don't know if you've ever read these books. They're great books to read, actually. So one thing is that it's all about, imagine you have three toothpastes in front of you in a shop. It's very easy to make a decision which one you want. Yeah. If you have 5 or 10 in front of you, that choice really becomes harder. You may still pick the same toothpaste. If you have 50 toothpaste in front of you, you go nuts because you have got no idea what to buy. But even if you know what you want and you take that one, people feel really bad about that choice. The more choice they have, the less likely they're going to be happy with that choice that they've made. And these two books are all about that. Yeah? So, and this is online. This is offline. This is a regular brick and mortar shop. There, that problem is already present. Online, this only becomes worse. We don't have 50 toothpaste, we have 5,000. Yeah? So the likelihood that customers are going to be happy with the choice that they made, had to make out of 5,000 items is minuscule. Yeah? And so, first of all, they have the tendency to not choose at all, because they're afraid that the choice that they make is something, the choice that they make is something that they're not going to be happy with. And, or if they do make it, they might not feel happy about that. And which means that you have this sort of these negative emotion associated with your business. You don't want that. And so one of the ways that we're using personalization is to actually help reduce choice. So even if you have 5,000 types of toothpaste, yeah, if you search for toothpaste, we might only show you 5 or 10. Yeah, based on sort of all the things that we may know about you as a customer. Maybe about your shopping history, maybe about sort of broader categories that we can put you into. And we may make an educated guess how we should reduce choice for you, such that if you make a choice, you are actually likely to be more happy with it. This positive emotion that comes with it. So personalization is sort of comes into three different forms. Similarities, recommendations, and zeitgeist. So recommendations, similarities, is item to item. Yeah? Customers have bought this, also bought that, a few this. Frequently bought together is actually a pretty important kind of item to item association that you can offer your customers. Recommendations all has to do with the individuals or the individual groups that customers belong to. Yeah, it's really all sort of recommendations. It could be based on sort of previous click streams. It could be based on geography that you know about customers. And yes, you know about the geography because you shipped to their house. Yeah, most likely. And Zeitgeist is sort of what we all know as bestsellers and things like that. So bestsellers, of course, the New York bestseller list is created once a week, and it's only two categories, fiction and nonfiction. We can do bestseller lists that are accurate in the past minute and for all the different categories that we have in terms of books and Amazon. It's actually very important, especially the bestseller or the highest. We've gone to the point where we give products that are sort of the number one bestseller in that category a little badge. That little badge is gold for that product. Yeah, it really determines whether customers, it actually has a lot of gravity effect in that sense. We also do things that actually don't work out that well, especially in the recommendation space. This was one that we did a number of years ago. It's called your digital soulmate. This is the person on Amazon that is in terms of purchasing just like you. We wouldn't tell you who it was, but we tell you that there would be someone like that, and then we would tell you what that person had also bought that you didn't buy, with the idea that that might be inspiring for you. Turns out, customers hated it. They hated it from the bottom of their heart. They hated the fact that there was somebody else just like them. Yeah, serious. Yeah, this was not a successful program. Now, I mean, maybe 5, 6 years later, with all the rise of social networking, things like that, maybe different privacy feelings. Although I think egos didn't really change that much over time. We could try it again. Not really sure whether this is a recommendation strategy that will really work for well. You can have many more inputs into these strategies. Yeah. So, for example, this is something I don't know if you can really read it well, but this is what this is input into our deals program. So people say what kind of deals they're interested in, and also what their locations are, because most of those deals are local. For example, it could be a hairdresser or something like that, a hairdresser deal. And you can say that if I want hairdresser deals, I really want them near my office, things like that. So the more input that customer voluntarily give actually really helps you. Also, I don't know if you've ever done this, I don't know if you're Amazon customers, but if you go to Amazon, it actually says on top, Werner's Amazon. If you click on that one, you actually get your whole page of recommendations, and you can actually tell us there whether this is a relevant recommendation or not for you. Especially if you just bought, let's say, a set of books for your daughters, that might totally mess up your recommendation system for a very long period to come. I've had this on Netflix, where I'm continuously being brought back to Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And so I think Netflix did something which I already wanted for a very long time on Amazon, is profiles. You know, sometimes you shop as a dad, sometimes you shop as a professional, sometimes you're the photography expert or something like that. So input is actually really important. Customers do that. Most important additional stream is the customer's social networks. If they are willing to connect those, and actually Facebook and Pinterest are the two that are most interesting. And maybe of the two, Pinterest is even the most interesting one of those two, because there's a lot of product recognition and product, let's say, liking that happens on Pinterest way more than it happens on any of the other social networks. So if customers are willing to connect their let's say, their other social media or the products that they use, for example, if they're willing to connect Pandora with Amazon. Pandora is a music station radio where you can build personalized radio stations. You know, we can use that, and the likings that people do, which songs they like, we can use that to actually give them very high quality music recommendations. So getting all of these feeds from outside of your business is actually, you can build recommendation systems that are highly relevant. And also, you can also build lots of other things. In this case, if you connect it to Facebook, we can give you gift recommendations for your friends and things like that. There's tons of things that actually open up that help you, that help customers make the buying decisions that they're looking for. Of course, you know, if you look at some of the advances that we've made or some of the programs that we put in place, often people see Prime as a loyalty program. It was actually, from our side, way more a strategic thing in helping customers, let's say, taking care of some of the cost of shipping. So initially, with Prime, you got, well, $79, and you got, you still get second day shipping free. Free, I mean, it's paid under the program. It also helped customers actually do more cross-category shopping. Because if you get this very large 55-inch flat-screen TV and you get it delivered free at home, yeah, because not only your books arrive free, all other products arrive free as well if they're part of the Prime program. Yeah, so Prime is now 10 years old this year. There's 20 million items in our catalog that are primable or that are available through Prime. And we've now added all sorts of other things to it. Yeah, there's 800,000 books that you get that you can read for free if you're part of Prime. And I don't know where the number is on here, but you get, I think, something like 40,000 movies and series for free as well if you're part of Prime. Yeah, that integrates again with some of our other devices and things like that. It actually it's extremely popular. Last year in the US, Prime grew, number of people using Prime grew by 50%. And this is year 10 into it, yeah? So it's becoming more and more popular. And there's many sides to Prime, of course. I mean, first of all, this is how the membership grows. Instant video is really important, learning library. Also, there's other very pushing Prime to the edges. I think Prime Now is a program to deliver goods within 1 hour. And we started off that in Manhattan. We now expanded it to Dallas, and we're rolling that out into other cities in the US as well, where we can deliver within an hour. And the other one, of course, can we go back one slide? Hope. Prime Air, the drones, is something that's been in television enough, you know, and so it's a very, very cool program. It's real. This is not a trickery. This was not, although the moment when it appeared in Charlie Rose's program was maybe a bit opportunistic, but it was real. Yeah, it's really, we're really experimenting with these drones in terms of delivery of goods to people's houses within half an hour. As you can imagine, that comes with a whole area of problems, both in terms of safety, as well as Walmart buying anti-aircraft guns, kids with slingshots. There's all sorts of things that you have to actually think about when you go into this business. The cool thing is, it pushes your innovative limits. Because what you really want to do is really improve on that delivery guarantee that you want to give your customers, and we will get there, whether it's drones, or whether it's other ways that may not be known to the public at this moment. These are some of our fulfillment centers. As you can see, they are big. There's a reason why I show you this, is that we couldn't do prime. Actually, let's go one program before that. The program we did before that was super saving shipping. For someone who has a trouble with S's, that was a very hard problem, very hard product. Super saving shipping was something where over $25, we would ship it for free. And it would take five to seven days before it would be at your house. People really bought this. Really were making sure that they had orders over $25, and then it would arrive at home for free. Before we had Prime, around December 12th, would be the busiest day of the year on Amazon, because that would be the last day that you would qualify for that kind of shipping to actually arrive in time before Christmas. When we went to do this savings program, we had to relay out where our fulfillment centers were to be able to afford this. Actually, that was not such a big deal. It went much bigger with Prime. Because when we had to do Prime, if you have to be able to very cost-effectively deliver these products within 2 days, here in the Netherlands, you can reach everything within 5 hours. The US is a little bit harder in that sense. And so being able to do these things in 2 hours, we had to completely relay out our fulfillment network to be able to afford this program. And remember, the $97, and now actually we raised the price to $99, does not cover the cost of Prime. Yeah? The cost really, it doesn't pay for itself. Yeah, it pays for itself because of the kind of purchasing people do and how much they purchase. It's not covered by the $79 or $99. And the other things that you see in there, the orange things are our robots, the Kivas. We have 15,000 of them now in our warehouses so that the workers don't have to walk that much, but actually these crates come to them instead of that they have to go there. These are our fulfillment networks around the world. Many of them, I think we have 67 large fulfillment centers at this moment around the world. A very important program, also related to Prime, because maybe, I don't know how it is here, if you guys shop on the American side, but if you are a Prime member, one of the first things you do when you search, you click this button on the side that says Prime, which filters all the products by Prime. And, so it filters all the products by Prime. It's a very important one, because it means that people only see products that are available through Prime. Many of all our third parties, of course, were not part of that Prime product. And there was another thing with third parties that were selling on the Amazon platform. They love to ship. They love to sell, but they hated to ship. Really, third parties were so bad in shipping, they would love this order that would be coming. And then they had to go to the basement, find the book, wrap it, bring it to the post office. It's actually the majority of the customer service contacts that we had were about third parties, where most of the Amazon customers had no idea that they bought from a third party. They just thought they bought from Amazon. And as such, they expected the exactly hardcore guarantees that Amazon would give them as well. So we started this program called Fulfillment by Amazon, where third parties or others, actually don't need to sell on Amazon, you can be any other seller. You can actually take your goods, put them in Amazon warehouses, you have to pay for shelf space, of course. And then we give you an interface where you can either, when you ship on Amazon, be a part of Amazon, we automatically integrate it in all the selling that you do there. But if you would be someone that sells on eBay and want to make use of Fulfillment by Amazon, you can do that as well. Yeah, and we give you an interface where you can say, send this over there. And we take care of fulfillment, returns, customer service, things like that. This makes also that anybody of the third parties that make use of this program automatically fall into Prime. This is a great deal for small third-party businesses, because suddenly they're part of this exclusive group, part of this exclusive set of products that customers continue to look for and filter by. So it's a very important program for that. Well, this is an infographic that comes with it. Anyway, another program that we do also around Prime, we actually get students in as early as possible if you want to. This is actually, these are our first brick and mortar stores. They're not really brick and mortar stores for us. It's actually at the campus. We've launched one at Duke and we launched one at Princeton, I believe, or Yale. where we actually, students are part of a textbook program where they can get textbooks at discount. They can also get them at very low rates when they choose to actually have them as electronic books. There's also an area where there are what's called lockers, where we can deliver goods to if that's what they want to, because most of them live in dorm rooms. You don't want to leave any products around because they're guaranteed to disappear. And so we, on these campuses, we're building these small pop-up stores where actually you can ship your goods to and you can pick them up there. Amazon Fresh is something we went into. If you really thought that retail had low margins, try groceries. That is actually it's not a business that was... So let me put it that way. So in the 90s, we had the companies called Webfam and others that really tried this. But what Webfam did was actually immediately go broad throughout the US in all cities without actually having a clue what it means to actually produce, to collect and transport and deliver groceries to your customers. It took us 5 years. We run this for 5 years in Seattle alone, slowly growing neighborhood by neighborhood to try and understand exactly what it means to actually deliver groceries to people. So it's a tremendous popular program. Yeah, just have to make it work as a business for yourself. People love it that at 6 we deliver, the most popular delivery time is 6 a.m. in the morning, meaning that people will wake up, they open the door, and the groceries are in front of them to start off. Magic. And so it's really popular. It's just that from a business perspective, it's much harder to make it work. We've been able to do that. We've now launched it in Los Angeles and San Francisco and I think Philadelphia, but I'm not sure. But slowly we'll continue to widen the scope of businesses, of cities where we're delivering this. This is a few things that... we launched this one on March 31st, where everybody thought this was a April 1st joke. The Amazon Dash is this button that if you push it, you'll order the product that is actually on the button. So these are really for repeat buys, like indeed, in this case, it is laundry detergent, but we have them around diapers, we have them around all sorts of other different things. And actually, it's just fun. Probably it's the vendors that are going to deliver these buttons. They put it on your products and you can use that. Is this going to take off? I have no idea, but it's worth a try. Yeah, it's one of those experiments that you do where you just go and see whether this is worthwhile. There's all sorts of, how should I say, gating things around it. You get texts on your email, texts on your phone to say whether or not you actually really wanted to do this, stuff like that. More important, it's actually built on what's called the Dash Replenishment Service. That is an integration into devices where automatically you can do reordering. Now, this we put this here, a coffee machine, but the first vendors that totally, the machine manufacturers that totally jumped on top of this were printer manufacturers. Because you will order new ink if the ink is gone. Yeah, it just happens. And so you can set up these printers now to automatically reorder from Amazon new ink if the ink is gone. Yeah, it's totally under your control. Yeah, but you can still, this is automatic reordering. If you talk about convenience, this is the type of convenience that you try to innovate towards. Yeah, platforms are important. I already talked about it a few. Amazon became a platform for others to sell on. Fulfillment by Amazon was a platform. We've created a number of these platforms, including Kindle, Kindle self-publishing, things like that. One of those, and it may not a name that you may have heard yet, is called the Amazon Web Services. This is division we started about 9 years ago. That was the pioneer in cloud computing. Basically, we took the internal scalable technologies from Amazon, added stringent security tools to them, and made them available to the outside world. Now, we are what Gartner calls the overwhelming market share leader with five times more the capacity of all the other cloud players combined. Yeah? We have well over 1 million active businesses using this in the past 30 days. And as such, this is a very successful, hugely successful business for us. Actually, to the point that it's going to be the first business that will be broken out in the earnings results this quarter from Amazon. One of the things that really drives it is it allows other companies to move as fast as Amazon is. You no longer have to think about your IT infrastructure. It is just there at your fingertips. You only pay for what you've used. Yeah, and this is a very important one because it drives innovation. If you lower the cost of failure, Yeah? If you don't have to spend $100,000 on hardware, then it's most likely that you're going to take a number of risks. Build risky new products. We've done it all the time. And if it's the cost of failure is lower, you'll pull the plug on it. Actually, so also in the Netherlands, you know, quite a few of retailers in the Netherlands are making use of it. Wehkamp, for example, which is, in my eyes, a true staple in Dutch retail. Even when I was here, this existed. Even when I was young, this existed. Yeah? Wehkamp is making use of the Amazon Web Services to drive the innovations within Wehkamp and actually speed up the delivery of new goods and products and services to their customers. Yeah, they have decided no longer to do this by buying their own servers and things like that, but to go and experimental and move much faster by actually using cloud services. And it's really important in the whole world of big data, because the more, if you have to collect all this data, yeah, and I remember that one of the speakers this morning, this afternoon, actually really mentioned that, oh, they were collecting so much data, he didn't know what to do with it. Well, you know, if he would have come to us, we would have told him how to do that. Yes, we would have a platform for that. You can store as much, you can give you all the analytics tools that you want. And there's a whole range of them. It's actually one of the cases where bigger is better. The more data you can collect in terms of this sort of big data analytics, the better it is. And for example, it drives recommendations. Yeah, it's really a case that the more data you have, the finer grain the result is going to be. Now, if you want to see where this goes totally wrong, go to your favorite search engine and type in funny Amazon recommendations. Let me give you a few here. Someone just bought an oil filter for his car and we recommend that he buys an album of the Jackson 5. Yeah? Here is someone that just put Japanese steak knives on his wish list and we recommend that he buys a copy of Windows 7. I don't know which one you want to commit suicide with, but... This one, the next one, I'll only show you very briefly, because there's a lot of these, yeah? This is a frozen rabbit. Someone sells frozen rabbits on Amazon, yeah? Hey, but if you see what we recommend to go with it, I'm not really sure what these people are doing with this rabbit, yeah? Okay, so you need more data. Actually, the thing that we should have done, we should not have given any recommendations there. Yeah? Why not? Because we just didn't have enough data. Yeah? And especially in that last case, believe me, I don't think we sold enough frozen rabbits to make a very solid recommendations about what you should do with them. Yeah? So if you look at analytics, there's all sorts of types of analytics. I mean, one of them is purely the things that we know already is analytics and reporting, looking backwards. We've got lots of tools for that for you to use. There's lots of more real-time analytics happening. And we have got tools for the Kinesis and others. I'm not going to bore you with that. But there's some really cool stuff happening there. For example, we've got a customer in Japan that has 30,000 sushi stores. And it's one of those conveyor belt sushi stores. And at the bottom of each of these plates, they put an RFID tag. And so they can measure exactly from when that piece of sushi is created to the moment that it is consumed, such that it can really truly optimize the freshness of each of their sushis and actually totally impact the way that they're buying all sorts of inventory to really optimize that. So really in real time they can do this. And this is a whole new area of whole new, it's not really that new, but I think in the broad sense it's new is being able to make predictions. Yeah, and so, and predictions are becoming well known all over the place, and especially at Amazon. Netflix's recommendations are well known, but there's all sorts of other things they're using. 75% of movies watched by people that are watching Netflix do that based on the recommendations. That's an incredibly high number. It has to do a little bit, why is it that high, with sort of the behavior of people. You know, sometimes you just go and sit in front of the television and you just want to watch something. Yeah, you didn't go sit there like, I want to watch The Avengers. Yeah, that's the other 25%. Yeah, but 75% is just let Netflix for them sort of advise them what they should be watching, what they like. And as such, this quality of these recommendations needs to be very high quality. And Netflix actually does this by also taking you through this interview process periodically, where you can indicate what kind of things that you really, really like. And if you actually go into that, Netflix never stops with that one. You really have to stop at one moment after an hour of giving them feedback. The more feedback you give them, the higher the quality the recommendations are. And we've been doing lots of this, what we call machine learning, which is the basis of predictions, for a long time. I mean, this is something where we started off with. This is the first web page that we ever had at Amazon. I don't know if you recognize that. We had a program called Eyes, which basically was sort of a prediction engine that if you like this author, maybe we should also recommend the other author to you. Later on, in the years after that, machine learning became more and more and more important. Where it plays an incredibly important role in is scoring orders for fraud. Yeah, figuring out which orders are fraudulent or not, or in a particular price category, or things like that. It plays an important role in inventory prediction. It plays a role in price setting. It plays almost a role in almost in many of our businesses. And when we did this, and actually so, we really saw that how much work went into machine learning that we built a service for it. And so what we did an experiment. So with two very experienced engineers, we gave them the task to build a gender prediction service, meaning that based on the person's name and some other information, whether they could predict what the gender of this particular individual was. Took them 45 days to, with all the machine learning tools that they were normally using for, to reach 92% accuracy. And then we actually released this sort of machine learning service that makes it that simple to do this machine learning. And took a very junior development, and within 20 minutes he had achieved exactly the same thing. Now what we've done, if we've released this for everybody else to use as well, yeah, comes at no cost. So if you run on the Amazon cloud, you can actually make use of this service whenever you want. And so once we've released this service, the explosion of machine learning within Amazon really took off, really broadly. And so all these different things, counterfeit good detection and things like that, or abusive reviews prediction. Is this review abusive? Because we don't like those kind of things. Is this a review from a family member? Things like that. All these kind of things that you can go to. Let me just skip through this a little bit. So what you can do, it's very easy. You build a model. You then go into sort of validation. You get a whole environment where you can actually use on accuracy. You can actually increase or reduce false positive, false negatives, things like that. And then once you've built that model, you can actually either do batch predictions, which means that, so for example, with fraud, we just push many things in at the moment that we ship. But you can also do real-time predictions. Yeah, you can actually have an API on that where you can then go to and say, once something comes in, once a review comes in, you immediately hand it over to the service. So give me a likelihood that this is an abusive review, because you never want to post those. Yeah, and so this is something that is available for everyone to use, so you all can go into the prediction business. But on this platform, there's many other third parties, many young businesses that have made their services available for other retailers to use as well. And I've just picked two or three of them that are really cool. Qubit actually has something which they call Visitor Cloud, which they've built for retailers, where they collect also for on and offline data, bring these things into one particular product that they have, Visitor Cloud, and where you can then do recommendations on, you can do historical data. All of these things is stuff that they do for their retailers. They have big retailers such as Target and others as their customers. These are just a few examples. They do recommendations. They do prediction of delivery times, things like that, or whether you've bought something in the past and might want to resell your video game. Metapack is another company. Actually, I just went into them yesterday in London. These guys really play an important role for many small and medium retailers that do not really want to deal with the UPSs and the FedExes and the Post and whatever of this world to get packages delivered to goods. They see there's a spider in the web between those transport companies and the individual retailer. They will produce. There's many different ways in which you can integrate with them, but you can actually give them the order. They will print the shipping labels, things like that. They will give you the box. They will take care of that things get shipped with the right shipping company, and they will handle the returns as well. And this is just a young business. Yeah? They're pretty successful. They have, I think, thousands of customers, thousands of businesses already in the UK running there, and they're expanding into Europe as well, including, I understand, they will come here to the Netherlands. So take a look at these guys. Metapack is what they're called. And the last thing that I want to talk to you about is often retailers tell me, yeah, that analytics is, yeah, we get that, but we don't have the data. Yeah, we haven't been collecting any data. We may have some sales data, but we don't really know anything that much about our customers. We don't know how they use our store and things like that. You know, maybe we'll get an intern this summer that will observe customers, how they move through the store. It's nonsense. You guys are sitting on a gold mine of data that you probably don't even know. I assume that most of you, if you have a brick and mortar store, you have security cameras. Yeah, and you have to realize that video is no longer a data stream to be watched, but it's a data stream to be analyzed. Yeah, and it started already with something like Dropcam. Dropcam is an internet-enabled camera device that you can use. It streams data into the cloud where it's being analyzed in real time, and you can set alarms. Like an alarm like, give me an alarm when my kids come home with more than two friends. Yeah, give me an alarm when the dog goes crazy on the couch. Things like that. We're really... Video is no longer something to be watched, but it is something to be analyzed by automatic processes. Now, all of you have security cameras in your store. All of you have probably security guys watching those screens. But those video streams are a goldmine. They tell you everything about your customer. They tell you how they move through the store, where they linger. They tell you what are the hotspots within your store. Yeah? They will tell you how many customers went in and out. They tell you something about the demographics of those customers. Because with such a video thing, you can quickly determine that this is a balding, middle-aged, old man that came into your store. Yeah, or things like that. There's many things that you can do there. Yeah? You can, all of these stores, I don't know how it is here in the Netherlands, but in the US, all checkout lanes have at least 5 cameras on them because everybody is paranoid about your own employees stealing out of the till. Yeah? And so there's all these security cameras on there. It means that you can also, in real time, know what is the length of your checkout line and whether you should open more checkout lines to actually keep those lines at a particular length that you've determined that you want to. Yeah? How do certain promotions work? Do people spend time in front of these promotions? All of these, by the way, are real results from analytics companies that really take your security data and give you this kind of real-time information back. This one is not done with... this is exactly where customers are looking at the shelf. This is not done by using your security cameras. This is done by putting... I don't know if you know Kinect, that belongs to the Xbox. Yeah, which is sort of a 3D mapping kind of thing. These guys put 10 Kinects in your grocery store, in those areas where you're actually interested in what our customers really looking at. And those Kinects will actually track sort of eye movements or head movements of customers while they're standing on front of your products there. Yeah, so there's so many cool things happening at this moment that will help you as retailers really propel in the area, in the new world of data analytics and help you serve your customers better. And most importantly, you have to see this. There is no way back. Yeah? Remember that when I told you about those early days when we had this wanted to make this decision about allowing third parties on the platform or not. Yeah, there was no choice for us. It was gravity. It was happening. There were many, many other sellers out there. If we wouldn't have let them onto our platform, there would not be an Amazon.com right now. Very simple. Yeah? And so you can try and fight this tide where customers want more personalization, where they expect them to be the most important person in the life of a company. Yeah? So don't fight that gravity. Just go with the flow, address it, and there's so many tools out here for you to help you right now. Thank you.